months, we've been thinking a lot about good news. Thinking about the good news of our lives, the good news of this community, and most importantly, the good news of God. And as we've been reflecting on this good news, we thought about all the ways that we participate in making good news. We have these banners that surround us, making connections, making community, making a difference, making friends, making Eucharist, and making holy. We have been thinking and embodying and praying about this good news. And as we bring our Make Good News campaign, our commitment campaign to a close, as we wrap up the final details, we might think that it's time for us to move on to a new theme, to think about something different in our life of faith. Well, the lectionary, or maybe God working through the lectionary, has other ideas, because the gospel passage we have just heard is all about good news. Now, to be fair, all gospel passages, as I'm sure you all know, are about good news, because that's what gospel means. Gospel means good news. But today, we hear from Mark Jesus' definition of what good news is. We hear in that opening of today's gospel passage, Jesus say, "The time has been fulfilled. The kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." That is a rich and packed sentence for Jesus to say. And it's actually pretty fitting for Mark's gospel that that phrase from Jesus, that sentence from Jesus, would be so packed, because Mark is the shortest gospel. And what that means is not that Mark has any less content or substance or profound sayings than the other gospels, but it means that for Mark, there are no throwaway words. Every verse has deep meaning to it. Every verse has to pack a punch, because there's only 16 chapters in Mark, and he's got a lot to get across. Now, that phrase from Jesus, that Jesus' definition of good news, is one that we could break down phrase by phrase, word by word, and preach sermons and sermons and essays and write books about them. But I'd like to still be the curate here at St. Luke's, so I'm going to avoid the temptation to do just that, to break down every word of that phrase. But there are some things that we need to break open and we need to flesh out. That phrase that Jesus says, that definition, can be really broken into two parts. Something about the kingdom of God, and then how we are called to respond. So first, Jesus says, the time has been fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come near. Now, the Greek of that come near bit is a little bit ambiguous, and there's a few different meanings we can take for come near. We can think of come near as in time, as that which was once long ago, once was long anticipated, is near, is close at hand, is just days or minutes or hours away. That come near could also be something about geography or location, and that the kingdom of God has come close to us. The kingdom of God is broken in Providence, it's broken in Warwick, it's on the doorstep of East Greenwich. But we can also take that come near to be about accessibility. That the kingdom of God, that which has been hoped for, and long for, and pray for, is within our very grasp. I think it's important for us, as we enter into and come to the conclusion of this prologue of Mark's gospel, these verses where Mark is setting the stage for the rest of his narrative, to hold those definitions lightly and together. To understand the fullness of what Mark is going to do with the kingdom of God, we've got to recognize that the kingdom coming here may be about geography and location. It might be about time. It might be about accessibility. So we hold those things together as we enter the concluding part of this first chapter of Mark. The second bit, how we're called to respond to this kingdom that has come near, this kingdom that is near in all of those various ways, is we're called to respond in two ways. To repent and to believe in the good news. Now, I don't know about you, but when I hear repent, I think of a very specific thing. I think of the need to repent of our sins, to seek forgiveness for our wrongdoings. I think of that act of confession, be it corporate or private. But that's not what biblical repentance is all about. That's not what Jesus is talking about here in these opening verses of Mark's gospel. Because biblical repentance, strictly speaking, isn't so much to do with our sins. but about reorienting ourselves. It's about turning around. It's about changing our minds to the way they are, to the way that they could be. So when Jesus says the kingdom of God has come near and we need to repent, what Jesus is saying is, hey folks, something amazing is happening and you've got to turn around and look. You've got to reorient yourself so that you can see what God is working in the world around you. And when we reorient ourselves, when we turn ourselves towards that kingdom view, we can actually believe that the kingdom of God is possible right now. Now, Mark is using that kingdom language very particularly. Mark could say the reign of God is coming, or the order of God is coming, or the way God meant for things to be from the beginning is coming, but he doesn't. Mark says the kingdom of God has come near, and Mark is doing that specifically so his readers and hearers know that what God is about to do in the world is different than what earthly rulers and kings are doing. That the way earthly kings have ruled and governed and led their people is not how God is going to lead and rule God's people. But that kingdom, that dream that God has imagined for all of God's creation, that's what the kingdom of God is all about. That kingdom of peace and love and justice and mercy. And so when we turn around, when we reorient ourselves towards this kingdom of life, we reorient ourselves to a position that says we actually believe that peace, justice, mercy, and love, the reign and rule of the kingdom of God might happen right here and right now. That's the good news. That is what Jesus is calling to in these first words that Jesus utters in Mark's gospel. Jesus is saying God is doing something new. Turn around, pay attention, and trust and believe that it will in fact happen. Now, in these verses leading up to this declaration of Jesus, amazing things are happening. Mark is building and constructing this intense narrative arc in these few verses. Mark begins in verse 1 by saying, this is the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And then Mark retells the prophecy of Isaiah, that great prophecy that the Messiah is coming. Then we meet John the Baptist. He preaches. He baptizes Jesus in the River Jordan. Jesus sees the heavens torn open. God declares to Jesus, you are my son, my beloved, in you I am well pleased. Jesus goes off into the wilderness for 40 days, mirroring what the people of Israel did for 40 years. He comes out. John has been arrested. He makes this declaration. And just when we expect something huge to happen, there is a major narrative letdown. After all of that, Jesus goes and hangs out on the docks. Jesus is walking along the Sea of Galilee and calls his first disciples, calls these ordinary, illiterate fishermen to follow him. Now, the call of these disciples for us is pretty miraculous and amazing. There aren't a whole lot of details in Mark's narrative, and I think there's something intentional about that because it's clear. Jesus sees them, Jesus calls them, and they go. There must have been something pretty amazing and miraculous that they saw in Jesus, that they would leave the comforts of their trade, of their family, of their social standing behind to follow a complete and total stranger. That is a miraculous banner of faith, to drop everything you have ever known and go do something new. But as I read this gospel this time around, that's not what I find to be the most miraculous thing about the call of Peter and Andrew, James and John. Now, what Mark's hearers and readers would have known, and that we might not necessarily know, is that the fact that these four are hanging out as fishermen, are working as fishermen in that trade, and they're not already a rabbi's disciples, means that they didn't make the cut. You see, in this time, young Jewish men would approach their local rabbi and they would say, Rabbi, I want to be your disciple. I want to follow you. I want to learn from you. And the rabbi would decide whether or not that person, that man, was going to be a good fit for that. And if they made that first cut, they would go and follow that rabbi around. And they would learn from that rabbi and they would study with that rabbi. And along the way, there would be test after test after test until the best of the best of the best remain. And then those people would go off and become rabbis themselves. So the fact that Peter and Andrew, James and John are off on the dock means that they're not the best of the best of the best. It means they didn't make the cut. And I don't know about you, but for me, that's a great deal of comfort. That God, when God takes the initiative, God doesn't go after those whom the world has deemed to be the best of the best of the best. God goes after those who didn't make the cut, those who've been cast aside. God seeks after, God initiates each and every one of us. And if God can call them, then God can call me. And God can call each and every one of us to do great and profound things. Because the truth of the matter is, there is nothing special about John, about James, about Andrew, and Peter, the one with the keys to the kingdom, the rock upon which Jesus will build the church, the one who makes that confession that says, Jesus, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. There is nothing special about Peter. Jesus, in starting this new movement, in recruiting his first team after making this great proclamation of the kingdom of God, goes to people who we might think are the worst poster children there could be. They've got no power. They've got no authority. They can't read. They can't write. They're truths. And yet, God, in God's grace, in God's mercy, in God's power, can do amazing things through each and every one of them, just like God can do amazing things through each and every one of us. And so here, as Mark is setting the narrative up, setting up what he's going to do for these next 15 chapters, we hear what the good news is. And we hear who's called to bring that good news. The ordinary people, the people who have every reason to doubt, the people who have every reason to think that they're not good enough to carry on the work of God. When we hear the call of these first four disciples, I hope in this lesson we can hear our call as well. When Jesus calls them, Jesus is calling out the very core of their identity. Jesus is saying, this discipleship adventure which you are about to go on isn't some task for your to-do list, but it's a way of life. And so because these are fishermen, Jesus calls out to them and says, follow me and I will make you fish for people. I will use the fullness of who you are, the completeness of your identity, to work marvels for the kingdom of God that has come near. And so when we hear this today, we can hear, you know, the engineer among us can hear, follow me and build my people. The teacher among us, follow me and instruct my disciples. The dancer, follow me and dance in the spirit. The artist, follow me and paint with the colors of creation. The stay-at-home parent, follow me and nourish my children. To each and every one of us, follow me in the fullness of who you are, with everything that you have, and build my kingdom. Participate in making good news with me. Because in the connections we make, in the community that we build together, taking this example of Jesus who is building his community in this early chapter in Mark, and the friends we make and the difference we make as we go out and build the kingdom, in the Eucharist and in making holy, we are embodying the good news that Jesus came to preach. We are embodying that repentance, that turning around, reorienting ourselves to God so that we can believe that everything we hear and read and pray in this space might actually happen. The kingdom of God is already and not yet. And the already of the kingdom is that when we say yes to God, when we take that first step on that discipleship adventure, the kingdom in that moment is fully realized. So we, as God's people in this place, are called to step together, that the kingdom of God might be fully realized at the corner of Pierce and Church. And if the kingdom of God can be fully realized on this corner, then it can be realized on Main Street. And it can be realized on Division Street. And it can even be realized driving up 95 headed towards Providence. And if it can make it all the way to Providence, then the kingdom of God can be realized through all corners of the world. And that is some profound and some deep good news that we can get behind. Amen.